Welcome everybody. This is Ramesh Chandran from BioBasics from Coimbatore, and this is Devi from Coimbatore from BioBasics as well. Welcome to ABBA, as we call it, Ask BioBasics Anything. This is our almost weekly, we missed last week, but almost weekly session at 6 o'clock on Saturdays to talk about things that matter to all of us. A little bit of intro to BioBasics for those who don't know about us. We are based out of Coimbatore. We sell about 300 odd varieties of products of organic food, and across India. You can look us up on our website. We have a online shop, and we also cover Coimbatore, Kochi, and Bangalore. Some of them might be attending this from those locations as well. So one of the key things that we want to do at BioBasics is to educate consumers and to kind of share our knowledge of whatever we do at BioBasics and what we believe in. We like to share that with our consumers, our friends, so that they can make more informed choices about their food habits and the way they live their life. So that's what we...
Yes.
Okay, let's try to make it less pompous. We just share what we do. And if you like it, take it. If you don't like it, dump it. That's the best I can do. I can't make it any less pompous than that. So, but basically our motto is be organic, buy organic. And that by definition, be organic comes first before buying organic. So we think it's important for all of us to understand nature, be part of nature before we start buying into the organic paradigm. Last year we used to do huddles, which is a longer version, but now this ABBA sessions are much shorter and a much more casual version. As you can see, we're just a fun talking. We're just sitting at our dining table and talking to folks out there. Yeah, with our Mia, the dog, sitting here waiting for us to get done with this. So feel free to place questions on chat. We will talk about today's topic. And then this is also being recorded. So feel free to see if you're missing it. If people have missed it, they can also see it in the YouTube channel. But that doesn't mean that please don't log off right now. We'd like some audience so that we can, talk. It's on purpose. Okay, so the talking point for today, basically the topic for today was, and it is, eat rice, lose weight as a question mark. The idea is not that you eat rice to lose weight, but the idea is that you can eat rice and still lose weight. And that is the essence of what we're going to talk about here. And the idea came up because we've come across so many people who actually suffer from the misconception that if you eat rice, you put on weight. And that's a gross misconception. And rice, whether we like it or not, is being vilified across many by different people across various spectrums. And I don't think it is, we at BioBasics don't think it is it's proper. There is vilification of wheat as well in terms of gluten-free and things like that, but we are not going there today. But that kind of a vilification is not something that we should accept, because let's use our common sense, which is becoming more and more uncommon as each day goes by. Remember that in my, when we were in college, in the 80s, we used to vilify coconut oil. And we said that, well, people were saying that, okay, coconut oil is the worst thing that can happen to your heart. And 20 years later, everybody is talking about coconut oil being the miracle cure for many things. Same also with almonds. And we said, okay, the almonds have these fats and it's very bad for your heart. And for almost a decade, people started not eating almonds. This was in the West, of course. And then it so happened that, oh, somebody woke up someday, some scientist somewhere, and said that, no, these things have omega-3 fats, and that's important for the human body. So let's remember to go back to basics. And that's one of the reasons we call ourselves BioBasics. But let's go back to basics, stick to basics, and understand and look back at history, look back at our tradition, and then understand what our food habits have been. If you look at our traditions in South India, at least, or for that matter, even in North India, rice is given a very, very prominent position in many, many of our festivals or other occasions. We use it in the south a lot. I'm sure in the north as well, it uses a lot. There are so many communities, especially south of India and even the east of India, who rely entirely on rice, and not just for the past 10, 15 years, but for decades and centuries, they have lived off rice. And let me remind you, these people were not overweight. There are folks in Southeast Asia who've been eating rice for decades and who continue to eat rice, and they are not overweight. So let us not vilify rice and say that, oh, rice has led to overweight or diabetes and things like that. We have to understand why it is. Now, just another anecdote or another thing that I would share is, before I hand it over to Devi, is I look at my grandparents who are not agricultural laborers, who were, who lived in a city, who were born in the early 1900s, 1900, 1910, and so on. And these are people who have lived their entire lives on rice. In fact, my grandfather used to constantly tell us that, wheat is not something that humans eat. I mean, there was a negative feeling towards wheat because wheat was new to him. He never grew up with wheat, but all these folks, they had sedentary lifestyles. They were advocates. They were, service employed people in the government and such. And they were not overweight, nor were they diabetic. So there is something that has gone wrong in the way we look at rice. And that is what we want to understand today. So with that introduction, if you will, and thought to this thing, I would like Devi to start talking a little bit about what has gone wrong and why is this notion. And if you talk to any physician or whoever today, would say the moment you see that you're overweight or you have diabetes, first you stop rice, switch to chapatis. And that is something that irritates us no end, because that's not the way it should be. Rice has got a place in its in the food, in the pyramid or whatever. At the same time, so does wheat, so do millets. So with that, I'll ask Devi to talk a little bit about what rice is. Why do we have this notion that rice is bad or rice is the villain?
Hello, everyone. I think she's almost said everything that has to be said. So the thing is, I would look at it as, it is not like we are, I don't blame people for believing what they do, because most of us have seen rice in a different form than what it was eaten by our ancestors or even our grandparents. I mean, we don't have to go that far back. So maybe the way we have rice today and is one of the culprits. So if the rice in that form could be a villain. But the rice is not to blame. Who changed the form of rice? We did it. So we have changed rice from what it was to what it is today. And part of it is because of the inexorable development of technology, because rice was previously processed with hand, which was very tedious. Maybe it also kept people from overeating, because if you had to pound your own rice, I would love to know how many of us would eat plates full of it. So, but when hand pounding of rice stopped, and when we went into machine milling or intermediate technology milling of rice, we still had unpolished to semi-polished rice. From there, we went to these large mills, which polish rice to a sheen. They have what they call, most of the rice that you eat from the market has the silky polish. Most of the rice has a silky polish, which means that there's absolutely no bran. It's pure starch. And then in the West, it's worse. You can actually take your rice, not even wash it, and put it into. It's also fortified. So you take away the natural goodness. You take away the natural fibers. Like we have mentioned in a previous session, the bran is taken to made into bran oil. And then we fortify the rice, the white starch, and then eat it. So it is the whole inexorable progress that is, that has created the situation. So how should your rice look like? What does your rice look like? That is a fundamental question that you have to ask. Does it, we all talk about the rainbow colors that we have to eat when it comes to vegetables. Everybody is conscious that we have to eat different color vegetables and in salads or in sabjis. But do we look at the hues of rice? Isn't it logical to believe that same way rice has a range of colors, and maybe we have to eat all these colors in rice. Maybe I don't know how we can. We have got a sample of the rices. This is just from our kitchen, our pantry. I have got some rices here, and you can just see, you know, the different hues of rice that we have. So I have not picked this up from BioBasics right now. It is from our home kitchen. Can you see the rices?
Madhu, can you see the rices?
Yeah, we can see the rices, yeah.
So here we have rice in different forms. So this was our lunch today. This is a black rice, kalamali phulo. So all black rices are not great for lunch, but this is a completely unpolished black rice, but soft. You have to soak it overnight and have it for lunch. So black rice is known for high levels of antioxidants and anthocyanins. You're just going to eat, you know, a bit of it with your vegetables. You're getting a lot of fiber. You're getting the anthocyanins, antioxidants, and whatever else comes with the rice. So this was yesterday's lunch. I had a little leftover. In fact, it is two kinds of rice. There's a bit of Kuruva red rice and there's a bit of Uma red rice. I think it's 2 days lunch leftover because this is what our girl Mia eats. So I just picked that up from the
restaurant. You may want to say it is a dog.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, otherwise they will think that we are feeding our child leftover rice and eating all the good rice ourselves. So here is the Kuruva red rice. This has got about 50% bran. This is the Kalamali Phulo black rice, which has got 100% bran. This is this is Ilipapu Samba, a white rice with 100% bran. That's why it looks off-white. It's semi-polished, I think. It's not the unpolished version. This is our idli rice, Ponmani red, which has about 25-30% bran. This is a centered rice. We also love white rice, but this is not 100% polished. It still has a little bit of bran. But because it's a centered rice, we have it white because the aroma comes out when it is mostly polished.
And
it is an occasional rice. And this is Uma, which is a red rice, about 40% bran. This is Chiteni, a new rice I'm getting from the farmer, which is one of my favorites. Which would have about 50%, maybe it's more like 60%, even though she was saying it's 50%. This is the puri made from the Mapile Samba red rice, the puffed rice. So it can be had as a snack. Again, it has bran, as you can see.
It's not entirely white.
Yeah, it's got its bran because it's roasted in the paddy. And this is poha, aval, made from the black rice, similar to the Kalamali Phulo. So, but this is from Karpukauni. Karpukauni is another black rice from Tamil Nadu. So this is another aval from the Mapile Samba rice, if I'm right. Yes. So it's a thick Mapile Samba aval. So this is from our pantry. Of course, we do have a couple of red white rices. We have Mulankaima. We have maybe Mulankaima or Gandhakashali. I think this was Gandhakashali. Yeah, did I say it was Gandhakashali? The centered rice. Yeah. So this is what we call the rainbow of rice. So each of these rice, like Sundaram and Aya, the organic farming guru says, each of these rices would have its own composition of micronutrients. Each one is a different variety. All these are grown organically without chemicals. And it is, you know, mostly from rice growing areas. So.
Okay. I don't know what he did. Hello, you are muted now. Guys, one sec.
Yeah, sorry about that.
So this is the rainbow of rices that we eat. So I guess, you know, when we eat these kind of rices, we almost have a colored rice maybe 5 days a week. We are committed rice eaters. Doesn't mean we eat rice 3 times a day. We have rice just for lunch, basically. You know, maybe dinner is some leftover stuff or maybe roti or something like that. But the rice we eat would be, you know, different varieties. So each of it gives us a different micronutrient. We eat much less. So there is 1 cup of rice, which is enough for 3 people, literally. So there is, for the 2 of us, Mia, our dog, has it. And there's sometimes, that's why there's some leftover sometimes. So which is what you know, it satiates us because of the bran, because of the fiber. We have it in combination with a lot of vegetables. So if you look at our plate, maybe the rice would form 1/3 of what we have. Because, and also...
The vegetables would form the rest.
Yeah, the vegetables or dals or whatever. So it's the way we have integrated rice into our diet, be it the rice. So we also have rice flour, which is red. So what we have done, contrary to this, is if you look at a conventional household, first there'll be only three kinds of rice or four kinds. I mean, which would be like white basmati, maybe white pani, white sona masuri, and then a white idli or dosha rice. And that is what is being had. And that is a lot of starch going together. So the same thing that applies to vegetables applies here also. It is diversity that's going to help us. It is diversity of the varieties. And each of these varieties, there are varieties which have more manganese, some which have more zinc, some of them which have, you know, more of something else. I mean, I don't even know the range of micronutrients that it has, because we have these long charts that tests reveal that this has more of this and more of that. And we don't even know how much of what we should have. That's the interesting part, because when it comes to our food, we really don't know the whole of it. So even what we are telling you today or what we are saying today is what we know. Maybe we are not completely right. We might be off the mark.
Yeah. So the caveat is that we are not nutritionists. We are not doctors. We are not physicians. So we are just sharing what we know. And it just makes, I think, like I said, you know, we use more of our common sense. And I think everyone should use more of our common sense. Just try and understand how our grandparents used to use us. Again, I've quoted Michael Pollan earlier as well, the American food journalist, who says that if your grandmother cannot recognize the food that you are eating, don't eat it. So I'm sure some of these rice varieties that Devi's talked about today, my grandfather would probably recognize at least one or two of them.
Apparently, but if it is my aunt used to cultivate chitteni. It is from Thrissur. So she used to cultivate chitteni. Uma is a more modern rice. But I think Kurva might have been cultivated by my aunt.
The critical thing to understand, I think we'll wind up with this and we'll open it up for questions. The critical thing is that I think some of these rices, like Devi says, if it is got bran, it fills you up faster, so you don't eat a lot of it. And once you eat it with bran, the way it goes into our bloodstream in terms of glucose and whatever the sugar that goes into our bloodstream because of eating the rice is in a very, very gradual way. So that it's gradually released into the bloodstream. So it doesn't put the metabolism of the body to undue stress, where it has to deal with a lot of sugar and a lot of. So, if you're eating pure white sugar, white rice, like you would eat sugar, white rice, white polished rice is almost equivalent to white sugar. So, if you're eating that, your body is going through a lot of stress in trying to adjust to the spike of sugar that you're having. So, we recommend going into some of these bran rice, even if some of those traditional rices, try eat with bran, as opposed to being completely white polished. Devi wants.
So yeah, today for instance, we have had this Kala Malli full of black rice for lunch. I think we ate at 1:45 too, mm-hmm. because we got late. We haven't eaten anything. We don't have tea. We are still full. We are still running on jeera water, which is our, elixir. So it's just still, I think, filling us. I mean, the fiber is there. We are completely not hungry. This is how it is. Afternoons with red rice, this is how it is. Because one of the keys I've realized, what he jokingly said about eat rice, lose weight, I was like very nervous about the topic because I said, no, it's a touchy thing. One of the keys, I suppose, is to retaining weight. I won't say lose weight. I said at least hold on to your weight is to not feel hungry. Most diets, I think, fail because we are hungry. So we are constantly trying to do portion control, eat less, and then we are hungry and then we just give up somewhere and then grab a packet of chips or grab a packet of something else and have it. The key is to have things with fiber, which are filling and which keep you full. So you just go, I mean, 5 hours, 6 hours, you just don't need, you know, you don't need to fill up your tummy. It's slowly, you know, going through your system. I mean, this is purely, again, anecdotal, again, what our experience
is. No, I think a nutritionist or a doctor would also tell you the same thing, that the bran rice actually releases the sugar in a very, very slow manner. And therefore, you can actually, your the energy that you need to do your daily activity, is, you know, you can hang on to that and you can continue to do that activity for longer with something like this. But having said that, you know, I think in half an hour, I would be hungry. So... so now I'll open it up for questions. Madhu, if you have any questions or anyone has any questions, happy to answer. And, you know, about these rices, we could do, we could talk for hours, but I'm sensitive to the fact that this is a long weekend. Tuesday is a holiday, so people will be wanting to get off. So please, if there are any questions, we can take them now.
I'm going to unmute Divya so she can ask a question.
Sure.
Yeah. Hi, Devi. Hi, Ramesh.
Hi, Divya.
Yeah. I mean, this is whenever it comes to diabetes or weight loss, people first cut down their rice. So even when I had gestational diabetes, the doctor was shocked. She was saying, "You take rice in any other form, and all the three meals you are taking rice in any form, some of the other form." And she first asked me to cut down the rice. So I've seen many people who cut down, even for weight loss, they completely cut down rice. They take a roti or chapati. I mean, this is a general myth now in India that the rice is unhealthy and the wheat or atta is healthier. I had a doubt, like, which one would you suggest, whether raw or boiled rice?
We use both. So we think... I mean, it's basically raw and boiled, at least in Tamil Nadu and Kerala. There are, you know, people have very personal taste profiles. Whereas in Karnataka, it's mostly raw rice, except in the coastal areas. Andhra also, it's raw rice. But Tamil Nadu and Kerala, I think most of the rice growing regions eat parboiled rice.
Yeah.
And parboiled rice is supposed to be more healthy because you do the parboiling within the paddy. So when the paddy is parboiled, all the nutrition from the bran also, you know, travels to the grain, inside the grain, which makes it healthier. Even after you polish it, there is much more nutrition within the grain. So parboiling is technically more healthy. Ayurveda uses more parboiled rices. So I would say parboiled, but it's a personal, if you have with bran raw rice, you still get a lot of fiber. So yes. I would essentially believe in keeping the bran. Most people struggle to have 100% bran rice on a daily basis because it tends to be sticky and a bit lumpy like this. Even the red rice can become, so
yes,
people
yes.
are
and
used
it,
to.
The cooking time is more, and also you have to soak it for a longer time, the bran, the one
yep.
with the
yes.
bran.
Yes, because the longer it takes to cook, the longer it will, you know, slowly digest in your system. So,
and also the cooking method, the traditional one was they used to put more water and strain all the water. But
yeah.
Even there is, many people disagree with that. The pressure cooking is not good when it comes to rice. I mean, it was my grandma who used to say the pressure cooking the rice is not good. They want to strain all the water away. But other way, the people say that when you strain all the water, we lose all the nutrients in it.
I've heard both these, versions. So I'm really torn. I mean, I would love to do more research, which I am doing to find out, you know, which is better. Because, today, even we pressure cook most days. There are days we would do the boiling and straining. The boiling and straining, when we do, we still have the kanji water. We both love
yes.
the kanji water. So we have the whole thing. When you pressure cook it, the starch stays in there. We have it. So both ways, we end up having, the whole of it. But I don't know, maybe a nutritionist can give better advice whether when somebody who's specifically dieting should strain it away and not have it. They might recommend that. I don't know. I will come back on that, you know, maybe on a later session, you know, have some more chats with people.
Sure.
give us more information. But if you're worried about the water, I guess what you should do, even in the pressure cooker, cook it. You can add boiling water at the end of it and keep it there for some time, you know, on a low simmer and strain it out. You will get excellent kanji even with that.
Yeah.
And you will get strained rice.
Yeah, and another thing is, I mean, I'm not speaking about the organic, but the normal one, they say, there are traces of arsenic in the rice.
There have been reports, people have got, that's a very good question you asked, Divya. There have been reports, isolated reports of arsenic lead, you know, the presence of heavy metals in wheat bran rice. Basically, it has been reported from certain areas which have a propensity to have heavy metal, you know, certain regions which already have. The second is you get it when you have a very heavy use of synthetic fertilizers. You know, continued use of synthetic fertilizer over decades has increased the heavy metal content in the soil. So that is something which is taken prevalence. But the choice is, of course, we are recommending eating organic. And in the organic rices, mostly because, you know, there is no heavy metal unless specific region or soil has it. In our case, most of the rices come from rain-fed regions where the rice is grown using monsoon water. We have tested at least, I think, 3 or 4 varieties of the rices that we have, and they are completely free of heavy metals and, of course, pesticide residues. So it has been tested because people raised this query with us. We did do sample testing of rices. So we know that it is there, but the problem is there with bran rices. But I don't know whether the heavy metal traces end with being in the bran and whether polishing it actually takes away the heavy metal completely or not is again a debatable point, even in chemically grown rice, because that has much bigger problems. Heavy metals, pesticide residues versus, you know, full starch. So
we can't control the water. Even the water can be contaminated.
Yes, that can happen. But, you know, to some extent, see, when in organic farming, you're not adding anything. So you're not adding the pesticide load. So
thanks, Divya, for that question. For those who are watching, Divya is our partner in Bangalore. And Madhu, if you can show that slide that we usually show. If any of you watching this is in Bangalore, please do watch. Please do get in touch with Divya at Bangalore South. And we have, I'm not sure Vanshu is here, but he represents our listening in Bangalore South. We obviously are in Kochi and Coimbatore, so feel free to reach out to us. So that was the commercial break. So so feel free to log on to biobasics.org. Look at all these rices. All these rices will reach you in 3 to 4 days, along with recipes online. And or you can order from Divya and Anshu, and that will also reach you. Or Kochi as well and Coimbatore as well. So Madhu, any other questions that that we need to take?
Yeah, one second. I'm going to stop sharing the screen. We have a question here. I believe from someone who grows rice and is wondering, many of the mills like to polish rice to an extent where it is so shiny, because that's what they say consumers like and that's what people take. So they are asking, if is there any place where are there mills where they reduce the polishing, and how is it done is their question.
So there are small mills which do accommodate this. I think it is like finding your organic supplier. So you do research, you find the trustworthy organic supplier. Similarly, rice growers, one of the keys to growing rice organically is to also find a neighborhood mill who will do it, process it the way you want to. So there are the very small mills which cannot do this grading very accurately, like the percentage of bran, but they can approximately tell you that this would come to about 40%, 50%. So it is a couple of trials. You do a trial, you see how much of the bran is left, you do the full unpolished. So you may end up paying more for the milling process, because the big mills, the full polishing, it's a very mechanical process. But having said that, they don't do small lots. But if you say fully polishing, it's much easier for the mill. So they might charge you less for it.
And they get the bran out of it.
Yeah, and they keep the bran. Here, you keep the bran. So you have to work with the miller. Maybe initially you end up paying more till you build a relationship with the miller and then figure it out. So if you are taking the effort of growing rice, I have a lot of respect for rice growers. You have enormous patience. You have enormous perseverance. I think you can extend it to finding your own miller too. And you will be able to do it, definitely.
They have a follow-up question. Is there anyone who can guide to make small sizes of such milling machines?
You will have to find your own, in your own neighborhood. It's not like there is a site to small mills. You will have to figure out small mills in your area.
We have a question.
The state you are in, the geography you are in, and things like that. Mill. See, we know, you know, which wherever we work with the farmers, what the mills are. See, people are struggling. It's a struggle. I mean, it's the farmers who have to kind of, you know, tell the miller, look, I want it this way. Insist, work with him.
I would suggest that do give us a call. Maybe Devi is in touch with several of these mills attached to some of our organic farmers. And probably they can help. So
only in the southern states.
Yeah, only in southern states. I suppose this is from south. So we can do that.
Yeah, maybe write us or give us a call. We'll leave our contact information.
Yeah, happy to help. Yeah.
Yeah. We have another question from the Facebook. Is Kuruva a bran rice? I think they're asking how much bran Kuruva has on it.
The Kuruva that we have usually comes with 50% bran. It had about 65, but 65 is not something which everybody is able to manage. So now we have settled for 50, which works for most people.
And when she says that, it means that it becomes a little bit for people who are used to white rice or softer rice. The bran increases, it's difficult to enjoy that as much. But yeah. I personally feel it's a matter of getting used to. Remember, I just would like to say this, that all my adult life, right from childhood till I was 44 or whatever. Till 44 or so, till I found some of these rices, I have been eating white rice. So, and it's only for the past 7-8 years that I've been eating these colored rices, if you can call it that, and the bran rices. And it took a while for me to get used to it. But if you're patient, if you are able to kind of, you know, go through that and really be open-minded about it, you will get your taste buds and your the way you enjoy food will automatically change and adapt to it. Trust me, trust yourself and try it out.
Typically, like a spouse, I'd like to correct him. We started eating with bran rices when we went to organic with the brown rices.
Okay,
which was 15 so maybe years
yeah
back.
Yeah so maybe 15 years okay anything more?
That's all for the questions.
Cool. So thank you everybody for joining us. I hope this has been useful. Do send in your questions if you have. You can reach us at on our Facebook handle, which is @BioBasicsIn. We are also on Instagram @BioBasicsIn. We have a YouTube channel as well. So reach out to us. We'd be happy to respond to any of your questions. And nice talking to all of you, although it's been just largely one way. But hopefully we'll have more interactive sessions in the future. But like I said, the rice thing is not just a half an hour session. We could actually do 2 days, 3 days talking about this and really getting into the details of it. But anyway, hope you've enjoyed it. Hope you've gained from this. And wish you a very happy Republic Day next Tuesday. And so we sign off from here. This is Ramesh and Devi signing off on behalf of BioBasics. And Madhu, the boss, is signing off as the host of the show. Thank you.
Okay. By any follow-up questions about rice, you can ping us, like I said, on our social media handles or our email or on WhatsApp numbers. We're constantly addressing queries from people on how to choose rices, how to cook rices. We do send instructions on how to cook rices. For every packet of rice that you get, you will get it with a cooking instruction. But people do come to us regularly and we have recommendations for whatever your requirement is.
Oh, last question. We have a quick question before we leave. Someone wants to know how is Govindabhog in terms of nutrition.
Govindabhog, I don't offhand remember, but Govindabhog brown is considered to be quite nutritious. I don't know how much of the nutrition is left in the white, but I'm told that even then it is good. Of course, when it comes to taste, it's out there on top of the charts. But it is, the brown Govindabhog is quite nutritious. But generally, brown Govindabhog doesn't move as quickly as we would like it to, as most people go for the white.
And yeah. we tend to use the white Govindabhog more as on special occasions. And a special dishes, not on a regular
basis. But people who like Govindabhog could go for the brown version.
Yeah, sure.
It's quite delicious. I quite like it, but, you know, there isn't... it takes a long time to cultivate the taste with people.
Yeah. So that was the last word from Devi. And we wind up with that. Thank you so much. I'll see you. We'll see you next week. Bye.
Bye.